Okay. There was already a lot about myself. I'm originally from Germany, did my first computer science degree there. I have a master's of science from Texas in telecommunications and software or computer science. I have done a law degree, a qualifying law degree for England and Wales. And yeah, some of the other things was already mentioned. I have been for a long time an entrepreneur, have run my own business in software consulting. And also have been an educator. I have lectured at several universities, and I have always a lot of fun with that. And I'm really happy now as a software development manager, I can continue that in one job. We have quite a lot of co-ops, and it's always fun to have the co-ops. Here's one of them. And that's, I think, a very, very good way for the students to get experience. And it's not everything can be very easily taught in a classroom. And those kind of co-ops experience, I think, very benefit for both sides, for us and as well for the other things, for the co-ops to learn something. Okay, about eSentire, my employer. We are a cybersecurity service provider, so we don't really sell products. A lot of security, cybersecurity companies just sell you some kind of product, you put in your network, and then everything's supposed to be good. you're laughing, so you probably agree with me it doesn't work like that, right? what we're really focusing on is what we call managed detection response. And that is quite innovative in the field. It's so innovative that Gartner actually created a particular category for us. So they were the opinion all the other security, or we were so different from all the other security providers that it was not really fair to compare them to us, I guess. our clientele is mostly SMBs, so we are not playing with a really big companies. They often have their own security teams. Even I'm the opinion, it's very difficult to do that for one company. Mainly we traditionally have worked a lot in the hedge funds business. We earn every year awards from the hedge fund manager association or whatever they're called. I don't know. Often like we just expect that, you know, we have to win that. But we're also in heavy open source consumer, which attracted me when I thought about starting with this company. Because I have been so long in open source in my own company, I have usually used always open source. So that was very interesting for me. I think there's a lot of really good technology coming out of open source, and it would be really a shame not to use it. The other side is a little bit more difficult, but we're working on that as well. We want to become as well a very good contributor for open source, and we have started some programs how to do that. It's not always easy to do in the corporate world, and you have certain responsibilities to clients, there are agreements, and all these kind of things, and sometimes it's not easy, but we're working through it, and we want to get better and better in that. And I think that is very, very important. Okay, the motivation for my talk. Before I'm getting further along here, I have lectured a lot, so I don't have any kind of problem of interaction. I would even encourage interaction. So whenever you have a question, just interrupt me, ask me. Maybe we even have a discussion about certain things. It's a lot more fun than if I just read stuff from slides or something like that. I mean, don't want to get too boring here. So my motivation is the theme here in FSOSS was Internet of Things, right? And actually on Friday, last Friday, something happened with Internet of Things. Does everybody know what I'm mentioning? Yeah. Huh? Yeah. So there were some attacks, right? And actually it looked like, I'm not sure how confirmed that yet is and how you can ever confirm that without any doubt, but that a lot of IoT devices were actually used as a botnet, right? And And that shows, well, we have some problems there. We are a security company, so maybe there's some growth for us. But there are more problems than that in IoT. And usually what you have in Internet of Things is you have this kind of fast growth of devices that you have to somehow to deal with, right? So what is the Internet of Things? Well, the best definition that I found is, well, they are like technical devices that somehow autonomously sense stuff, right? And you have to somehow deal with that. And so it's more consumer buy products that have these kind of capabilities, it's more you have to deal with, right? So what it really needs is scalable solutions, right? And often fast scalable, because sometimes your product takes off and you don't even expect it that it grows so fast, and you have to deal with that then, right? So, and that is something that generally, I think technology in the past hasn't been really good. Most of the time, I mean, think about databases, we had this kind of vertical scaling, right? I mean, well, just buy a bigger IBM or HP machine or Sun at the time or something like that. So it was always this kind of replacement mentality. We had a box that wasn't good enough, so get a new box that is better, right? With all the headaches coming with that. So that is not really scalable in a big range. So we need to go a different way, and that's what I will a little bit talk about. So there are some certain challenges in the architecture. How do we architect systems that are highly scalable? And then when we have architected them, and you know, okay, I'm a dev manager, so I could think, hey, I create the system, my devs implement it, and then we just somehow forget about it, right? Right? Is that reality? Yes, you say. We have to talk. Well, it's not so easy, right? After the dev work is done and the testing and so on, we say, hey, you know, now how do we manage it? How do we put it in production, right? So with scalable solutions, there are as well additional challenges to it, because it's not like, hey, you just install it once, right? Because it's one box or something like that. Well, and lastly, as I already said, security is an issue as well. So, what I want to talk about in this kind of area is what kind of technologies are essential and helpful to build these kind of scalable and maintainable solutions? How do you architect them? What kind of providers can help you with some of these things? Because not every startup has the capital to build some assets, to build a big server room or something like that, right? So there are some other solutions that you can use. Cloud is the word for that. And then obviously some guidelines for better security. Okay, so far, everything clear? Okay. To go a little bit back, what are we doing? Well, in a sense, we do something that I would call is somewhat an Internet of Things. We as a security service provider have devices in the network, in our clients' networks, on clients' machines, or they collect information from different sources, either from the internet, from the dark net, from logging sources of things that happen, and that are signals for us, or can be signals for us, right? So they're autonomously gathering information and sending it to us. So that's very, very similar to this kind of definitions that I talked about. And then we have an analytics back end that basically tries to make sense of all this kind of stuff, right? And you see, we have more and more customers. We have more and more signals, because we get smarter and smarter, what could be an attack, what could be a problem, what could be something that indicates ransomware, what could be a botnet, right? Those kind of things. So, you know, it gets more and more hard to figure out what is going on because the noise is very high, right? Probably a very high percentage, let's say 90%, just to pick a number, is something that is totally okay. And you want to fix, say it on the issues, right? Only. That's why actually security is so difficult. It's not like so hard. Yeah, okay, the hackers and people who try to exploit things, they're always somehow a step ahead, but that is something you can always catch up again, right? But the difficulty is you have all this information that comes to you and you don't know if this file transfer was actually somebody just downloading the new Google Chrome version that just came out, or is it some malicious piece of software that has nested in somewhere and tried to load further components or something like that, right? So that is what's usually happening with malware. So that is what we're doing. So we have some experience in that. We have extensively changed our whole infrastructure in how to do things. And what I present here is a little bit of how we do things and in a little bit abstracted way, because obviously I can't give everything away here. But I think that is something that is just creating good practices in general that industry-wide can be used. So one of the, let me just go through some terminology because that is often used in these kind of areas. One is SOA, so service-oriented architecture. So that is basically that you build self-contained services in form of components, and you can, you know, components use other components, services, or at the end, an end consumer will use this kind of service to get a certain information. And then we have containers. We had already some presentations about that in the morning. Who was here for the Docker container one? Okay, a couple. Who doesn't know at all what a Linux container is? Okay, so let me go a little bit into that. So Linux container is a form of isolation. We know that, I think most people know what a virtual machine is. So a Linux container is not so different in that. The only difference is that it is far less overhead, because we don't create a whole new virtual machine, including kernel and virtual devices and all these kind of things. All of that is reused from the original machine. But we use technology inside the Linux kernel that is called user spaces to separate different processes from each other. So people who have used Linux a lot in the past probably know Shroud. So that is one of those technologies we had outside the kernel to try to separate things from each other and don't allow them to interfere, right? And containers work pretty much the same way. So the low overhead allows us to run far more containers on a physical host than we can run virtual machines. But we get a lot of the same kind of isolation. So that increases security in the end and allows better management of different kind of services. The next thing is orchestration. Orchestration is the deployment of those containers. So the containers are now units that we run somewhere. They come out of what is called images. So let's say similar like an ISO gets you an OS, and Docker image gets you a Docker container as a starting point, right, from where you go on. But we somehow now want to run lots of them, and we want to scale them, right? And we often want to do that dynamically. So that changes over time. So we have to somehow orchestrate that. We have to somehow manage that. So what is the goal that we want to achieve? The goal is building this kind of flexible, scalable production environment. And another thing that we want to do is we want to be able to deploy fast. So automated, that is reproducible. And we want to get more and more into continuous deployment. So a lot of people probably know continuous integration. That is a mechanism that is used now in development for quite some time. And in open source, I think, has as well embraced it pretty heavily. Jenkins is one of those tools that was talked about here as well. That is a tool that allows this kind of continuous integration, which means, you know, every time you commit, you integrate the commit, you run all your unit tests. So that's something I probably should mention as well. If you want to do continuous integration and continuous deployment, you need to do heavily automated testing. That is an absolute must, and it has so many advantages, but I think that is already accepted for several years now, so I don't want to get further into that. And another important goal, I think, is using the right tool for the right problem. I have seen in the past too often that people end up with having this kind of very special tool that they really like and that works for everything. Well, not really. that is a problem. But again, there's where you get then, on the other hand, in troubles when you say, hey, well, I have 50 different tools that I could use, right? I mean, not that do the same thing, but that solve my 50 different problems. That is now a maintenance nightmare, right? And a deployment nightmare because I have 50 different services. Well, that is the idea that we somehow automate that and get that in the way, and then using the right tool is far easier. Okay. Let me give you some kind of basic architecture, what I'm talking about when I talk about this kind of microservice architecture that is service-oriented and so on. So usually what you have is you have requests coming in, right? So, right, clearly here. So for instance, these requests might be these kind of devices that send us information, right? We have to process that somehow. Or the request might be some user behind a UI wanting to have some information, right? All these kind of things are basically different requests. They're in an abstract way, all the same thing, right? So now we go to the first stage. Well, we want to be scalable. So scalable means we don't want to do the vertical scalability anymore that I talked about before, just buying higher powered machines, but we want to horizontally scale. So we want to have multiples, and then we can add on in a flexible way, right? So we usually have something that's called a load balancer. That basically deals with just, hey, you know, it's easier to just hit one point and always know to hit to this point. And there are ways as well that you can have failover between different load balancer. Either you have physical load balancer or software load balancer. All of that has a lot of flexibility, what exactly the right solution for the particular problem is. Often there is DNS load balancing as well. Everybody who has ever requested a DNS record, for instance, for www.google.com or something like that, you see that you get multiple DNS addresses, right? So that's a form of load balancing as well. So those go then to our first stage of nodes. And those nodes, in our case, are usually the same ones, right? So I could just do this as well to say we have more nodes. So that is, for us, APIs, and I'll talk about what kind of APIs a little bit later. So these API nodes have one main functionality, and that is to process a request in the form of, is it a valid request? Is it authenticated? We talk about security. Do we need to throttle? Right? We just talked about a DDoS attack. So maybe we want to throttle stuff from certain IP addresses or something like that. Those kind of things. So common things that are totally independent of the particular request, but it's just a general thing. Every request needs this kind of handling, right? So when we have done that, we put that into, I like always to put in a cloud here, that is basically a messaging broker. And I will go a little bit later into what that exactly means. And then we go out and get to our microservices. Not Microsoft, microservices. Pardon me? Yeah, I think Microsoft is very monolithic, right? But I think they learn a little bit. Azure, I don't know. I haven't really looked into that. But so in a lot of ways, that is the simple form of architecture of a microservice or microservices. Because each of those microservices now can be different. And again, we can scale them in a flexible way, however we want to. So if we say this one is really overloaded, we scale it up 5 times or something like that. This one is really not used, we scale it down 2 times or something like that. All these kind of possibilities are there, right? So that is the main idea. And then you can have pipelines of those services, right? So this service may call another request on the top for another service. And then it's almost like a Lego box, right? You have your Lego pieces, there are certain specialities, and then you put them somehow together and you get your whole system, right? So that's the whole idea. So the simplicity actually makes a lot of things easier, because in this service, I don't have to really think about all the other things that another service does. If I need it, I just call it, right? So it is not so different. How many people here have done object-oriented design? Yeah, and you know there are object-oriented design patterns, right? Well, in the same way, I can see a lot of microservices patterns, right? It's like you could almost think, hey, there are different objects and they just communicate with each other through certain patterns and do things, right? And the whole does what we want. So that is the general idea. Okay, and if you look really at it, and it's a definition of the SOA, which says it's independent components, right, that do certain services, that's what we do with microservices. Actually, I often say, we should get away from microservices, we should do nanoservices. It's cooler. But the idea is, you know, again, single responsibility principle, right? Same like with classes. Don't make your services too big, right? Think really about where you can do it. If you have common things, you can always use common libraries that you just use in different services that do these things. So you can still stay dry, right? You know, dry, don't repeat yourself, kind of thing. So that's the important thing. Each microservice is an independent service. And each service provides responses to requests either from the outside or from inside the services. Okay, now I talked about the APIs here. What are the APIs? Well, in order to be fully scalable, there need to be certain properties on what you expect the services and the APIs to fulfill. And one of them is you provide all the functionalities as needed. So that is what you usually use CRUD. You need to create things, you need to read things, update things, delete things, right? That's usually the thing you do. I think most of the things you can transform into these kind of processes. This kind of APIs have one little problem. to start to rethink a little bit, and that is actions. We don't have actions there, right? But then again, a create is an action, a delete is an action, but it's not like that you say, hey, I'm just doing a method call or something like that, right? We are more specialized there. But it still works. You just have to be a little more creative in how you do things. And there's a reason why we don't want to have these kind of actions. The RESTful APIs are really mostly based on the HTTP protocol or HTTPS, again, security. We want to be encrypted, right? So that is a very good protocol because it's always, it's a very common protocol. It's used in browsers. So it's easy to use. You can do AJAX calls in web UIs very easily. And it's as well, a lot of the technology that a microservice would use has these kind of APIs. If you think about it, MongoDB has RESTful APIs. Even Docker has RESTful APIs, right? So it's a very common protocol. And that helps as well because, again, we said services might call other services, so they can use the same protocol again that they would use for other services as well. The important property of RESTful APIs is that they are stateless. That is what I often see as a problem when those things get designed. Statelessness means any request you send is totally independent from any other request that will be sent or has been sent before, right? And the reason why we need that is because we have these scaled nodes. And we don't want to, in I think, which session was that, the Kubernetes session? There was something about statefulness. Well, you can do certain things with load balancers by doing some session affinity and those kind of things. But now, what does it get us? Because we have now a lot of work to do. If this particular node goes down, what do we do then? How do we create the session? All these kind of things. I want to have simplicity, right? So I don't want to deal with that. So what I'm saying is every single request is supposed to be totally independent. And in this way, one of those nodes goes down, it's just routed somewhere else, the next request. Right? And that still works because I don't assume that it goes to the same node anyway. Right? And as well for the whole performance, right? I don't have to deal with, hey, there are now all the sessions hogging this one node. How do I get them redistributed or something like that? You know, a lot of the really hard problems in computer science, I'm just, you know, don't deal with because I say, I just have this property that says it's stateless. I don't have to deal with it. But it, again, it requires the design to be right. It needs to be stateless at the end. And that is the thing, because the containers or the nodes are basically, for me, ephemeral. They're not persistent, right? I will not store any persistent data on any of the node, because again, that changes the whole stateless model, right? If I save something here on this node doesn't have the ability to get to it, right? Or they would have to have now a complex communication way of, hey, I figure out where the node is, right? You have to have it where you do persistency. That's why you have these kind of clustering mechanisms in databases like Cassandra and Mongo, where you shard data and certain data on certain nodes. But through the sharding, you have a key that very easily allows you to detect which node has the information, right? So we don't want to do that in the ephemeral services. Another big problem is configuration management. This is what I haven't put up here yet. I assume that those nodes come up at any time because I scale them up, right? Or they're replaced because hey, there was a software bug, for instance, and the containers crashed, or the node crashed, and I don't really deal with this problem at the moment. I just spin up another one, and it's ready for the next request, right? But when they come up, how do I configure them? How do I tell them, hey, like when you have services, where your underlying services, like databases, persistency, or something like that, how do I get to that? Conf files don't work in containers very well. How do you get the conf file in the container? Right? I mean, it's an isolated space. We actually do not want to have any changes from the outside in there. That would be a security problem, actually, because now I could introduce things in there. It's far more secure to just run the image how it is, right? So what we do is configuration management. We have similar like persistency in database, we have a configuration management, and every container or every node that comes up basically knows how to connect to the configuration management system and then gets the configuration. Good examples are Zookeeper. Zookeeper is actually used by a lot of software. By the way, all of them are open source. Zookeeper is used by, for instance, Kafka. What else uses Zookeeper? Yeah, I think a lot of Apache products use Zookeeper. Etcd is a new one. I like it better because Zookeeper doesn't have APIs, RESTful APIs, so the configuration of, you know, puts the configuration in and out is far more complicated than it needs to be. But Zookeeper actually has other functionality as well. It has these kind of leader elections for clusters and so on, and I see that far more the responsibility of Zookeeper than configuration management. We used it originally because we had already systems with Zookeeper, which we needed Zookeeper, and we just had a free system where we could do configuration management with. Etcd is it's from HashiCorp, right? Consul is from HashiCorp. So etcd is from CoreOS. Yeah. So CoreOS is somehow a minimalistic Linux version that is specialized on running containers. And they use etcd for their configuration management of their cluster nodes. So they already use it in this kind of way. That is a very good thing to use, especially when you use Kubernetes, for instance, that has already etcd as its configuration management. So you have it for free there already. Consul is another thing that I'm really burning to look into because it seems to give a lot more functionality for configuration management itself and extends the features a little bit from the other two. That's from HashiCorp. They do a lot of open source as well. But we haven't really had the time to look into that yet, but that's definitely an interesting solution for configuration management. Okay, now I go towards the infrastructure. You have to run all of that somewhere, right? So where do you want to run it? Do you build your own server farm, or do you find other solutions? Cloud services allow you to do that. They're very good for getting something up very, very fast. You don't have to order a server, wait for it, configure it, all this kind of stuff. It's already there, right? They also give you a lot of already infrastructure services. They often have some kind of cloud storage. They have other services. They might have already messaging brokers that you can use, caching, all kinds of things. But what I find with cloud services often is the vendor lock-in that you do. So we use extensively AWS, and we have used a lot of their services, but they're very specific. They're often not standards, right? So you have to be a little bit careful with that. It probably helps you very, very fast to get some MVP going, but then you have some more work getting away from it and find some more generic solution, especially if you have to run it in different places, not only at this particular provider. And another problem that we found is hidden limitations. A lot of these services that they provide are shared services. So you're not the only user that uses this particular service. And in order to not have the service crash because somebody behaves badly or you have a bug in your system, there are limitations that then throttle you. And then you sometimes think about, hey, why does my functionality doesn't work anymore? You are throttled. But you know, it's not always so obvious. So that's one of those kind of problems. Any questions to that? Yeah. Yeah.
What are some of the ways you could kind of ease that?
Well, if you can afford it because you have the time, often it is better to use your own service, even if you run it at the same cloud provider, right? So for instance, I will get a little bit more into messaging brokers later, but instead of using SNS or SQS from Amazon, you can run your own RabbitMQ or your own Kafka cluster, right? So in this moment, and if you go to the next step and run it in containers, then you start to more and more abstract from the particular vendor, right? From the particular provider of the cloud service. And as more abstraction you can achieve, as easier it is to just move things around. That is the solution that we are going for. Yeah.
So by that you mean you're basically renting generic virtual machines and not using any Amazon specific services?
For instance, yeah. Yeah, and that might have two different effects, right? I mean, think about as well about the history of cloud services. Amazon, at very early stage, used the eucalyptus system and made it more and more proprietary, right? So they are very, very proprietary in a lot of the services they do. Some other vendors have gone a different way. A lot of open source has changed from eucalyptus to OpenStack. And OpenStack, maybe, I'm not 100% sure about that. I'm still looking into those kind of things. But the hope would be that a lot of those services create a certain standard. And when you get the standard, and the standard is provided by the cloud provider, then you don't have a problem to move either, right? Because you know you can use the service the same way at another cloud provider as well. The question is, what is the benefit? What is the reward for yourself and what for the cloud provider? Because maybe some cloud provider would like to have you log in, but maybe they will see that at the end that is to their own detriment and they adhere more to standard. And that is something we have seen through the computing industry for a long time. I mean, look at the difference between Apple and IBM. IBM used open standard, a lot of new hardware you could put in your IBM PC. It got far more popular. Apple was always closed and, well, it had still its community, but it never got so big, right? So maybe we find something similar. Well, I think that is already a lot of the things that I talked about. Some more of the things is something that you need to consider as well, and that has as well to do with security, is actually it's not so simple to set up a cloud service that you would think. It's not like that you just spin up some kind of instance and then everything's fine. You still have to work a lot on the networking, on security things, security groups, ACLs, all these kind of things. Another thing that we were very surprised is we started in one region, in the east region of AWS, and all the services were available there. And then you have to do something because you're a global company in, let's say, Tokyo, and you know, like they're only 10% of the services available, right? So really check out if you have these kind of expansions that need to come in the future from the beginning, what is available where, and that allows you to make better decisions what service you use and what you don't use. Another thing that we run into is sometimes we have to do communications between different regions, and not all services do that. it's something as well that you wouldn't think immediately, but that are just some of the flags that we found on the way. What else? Yeah, and they have, actually Amazon has their own container management service, which is quite good, but again, I think it's more proprietary, it's not so much standard. The ECS system, so it allows you very easily to work with load balancers, but again, you can't use the same orchestration ways that you would use with other providers. We have also looked a little bit into Google Cloud. It has other advantages. I mean, Google has released Kubernetes, so a lot of the things are built for Kubernetes. It's very easy to put up a 20-node cluster of Kubernetes. It takes like 20 minutes. You don't have to do a lot. So if you set on doing Kubernetes or building Kubernetes up over different providers, then that might be something that works better. It's not as refined. It doesn't have as many services as AWS. But also, I think there's less vendor lock-in at this time. So that's where we get to the next point. So now we have decided we have a certain infrastructure. May it be a public cloud like AWS or Google, or maybe we build our own cloud as a private cloud in our own premises, on our own hardware. Let's say we use OpenStack or something like that. How do we manage the infrastructure? So it's not only the services that you have to manage the infrastructure too, because we work in a lot of flexibility. How do we know today how many compute nodes we need for a certain particular purpose, right? So how do we know that the networking infrastructure we put in place still works in the future? So it's far easier if you do that software defined. Another thing is if you do it manually, it is very difficult to reproduce. So a lot of things in continuous deployment is reproducibility, because every single time you do it, it should happen the same way. I have put something in one region, I want to put the same thing in another region. I don't want to go through some UI and put those things in and type everything in. Beside that, I always have typos and everything doesn't work at the end. So I want to somehow make that somehow like CodeLite 2, right? I can revision that, I can repeat, run it. So those kind of things are very important. AWS provides a quite good tool at the beginning. It's called CloudFormation, where you can automate some of those kind of services, but it has some deficiencies. They have done a new release now that has solved some of them, I think. We have already moved on. Oh, the YAML stuff, yeah. Well, it was originally written all in JSON, and now you can do it in YAML too. So one of the problems is, what's happening there with my computer? Oh, interesting. I think I have some malware. So it only works for AWS, obviously, so you have a vendor login again. It's not dry. It's very, very difficult to do multiple things the same way just by modularizing it. It's not possible in CloudFormation. It's very difficult to split up projects because often you have to refer to objects, let's say a VPC, a virtual private cloud, or a certain instance, or a certain load balancer, or a certain DNS zone between different projects, and you can't really reference it very well in what happens here? In CloudFormation. So. Where was I? There. So actually we looked a little bit around, looked at some tools. What was the other one? Sparkle Formation. It's a really nice Ruby tool that does CloudFormation stuff, and as well, you can use other providers too there. The nice thing is you can actually write Ruby code inside your declarations. Like it's this kind of chef and puppet thing, kind of, you know, like one is declarative, one is programming. but we have decided, I come back why we have decided against it. What we have set on is Terraform. Again, it's an open source product from HashiCorp. It's quite good, but for me, it's still not abstract enough. What it allows you to do is to define infrastructure for different provider. So OpenStack would be one of them, Google Cloud, Microsoft Azure, AWS, some other ones. But it's still specific. You have to say, this particular instance is actually an AWS instance. So it doesn't abstract the provider totally away from me. This is where I really would like to get. Unfortunately, I haven't found a tool for that yet, and I'm not sure. Maybe there's some movement in open source, and hopefully we can contribute to one of those things where something like that happens. But you can put infrastructure in multiple providers, even not abstracted. It's declarative, it's modularized, so I can say, hey, I have a certain particular way how I set something up. With I need always three instances, I always need a load balancer, I always need this kind of networking. I put that in a module, and then I just call the module multiple times with parameters, and it sets up multiple those kind of things. And I can link between different objects, and I can link between different projects, because I can import actually states, and I can define a certain object actually that exists is named in my configuration this way, and so I have an association. And it keeps state. So if I make a change in my configuration, I actually can run a plan command, and I see what all will change. Because again, I don't want to re-tear everything down and put it up again, because it's supposed to run continuously. I only want to do changes, right? And I don't want to have any outages. So I can see what will happen. So that is very, very good as well. So what technology to use? I'm going a little bit faster through those kind of things. Messaging brokers, what we really have settled on is RabbitMQ. That gives you probably the most complex ways of routing things and the most versatility. Kafka is a very high-performing messaging broker, but it's always the same thing. You send it through, and you can read from it. There's not a lot of ways. Like in RabbitMQ, we can do RPC calls. So we have one way and a way back. Kafka wouldn't deliver something like that, or not very easily. Databases, obviously. MongoDB is very, very interesting. We use as document stores, so it's not so much for querying or something like that, or you query usually only the main index, but you have all the information there. So use combinations. Cassandra is very, very good in building querying, especially time-sensitive things. So time series, that is what Cassandra is very, very good. Elasticsearch is like very good for full-text search. And then what we're really thinking about is using combinations. So graph database for relationships, and then the documents themselves on MongoDB, for instance. Caches, obviously Redis is one of the main used. Isolations, I already talked, Linux container, orchestration. We like Kubernetes a lot. We're putting Kubernetes at the moment into production. I have done a lot of research as well with Mesos. Mesos is a little bit more flexible. Kubernetes is really only for containers. Mesos can do things like Hadoop, Spark, I think. I'm not sure, but they have Marathon as a scheduler that's very flexible. You can almost do anything with it. Docker Swarms is another one. I'm not so happy with that one, but it's a different story. And then infrastructure management. Again, if you run your own premise, OpenStack and Terraform is currently the best thing that we found. So how do you choose technology? That's one very important as well, because you have often so many solutions that you could use, right? So what we found is, number one, it needs to fit the purpose, right? So, and in this way, again, because we have so many different services that are all independent, we can actually use the right technology for the right problem. We don't need to say, hey, we have this database, and we don't want to have 50 connections to databases from one service. No, but every service is independent, so theoretically we can use 5, 6, 7, 8 databases without any problem. Every single service only connects to one. So not this kind of one shoe fits all sizes kind of. The second thing what you really need to look in open source products is the community. I mean, a product in open source stands and falls with the community. So we look for commits, how often is it released, how many different contributors are there.
GitHub stars.
Well, yeah. Can be misleading too, because that just means people like it. I don't know if they really use it or if they contribute back, right? That is really the important thing. It's very, very expensive in industry to somehow replace a stale library or a stale product or something like that that just died, right? We need to have this kind of continuity. Okay, now last point, security. What does security mean? Well, that is a big problem, right? Everybody thinks something different in security. What does it mean? Access to the service. So do we only allow certain other services to connect to it, or limitation in the access? Do we protect from exploits or vulnerabilities? Do we want to protect private data? Or do we want to protect the system to be hijacked, like those IoT devices that then are misused as a botnet, right? So generally, it is very, very important to lock things down. I mean, the normal hardening that we all know from Linux for a long time, if you go in the cloud, put the right ACLs in it. Restrict access to only to what is needed. Especially when you do it software-defined, you can always revise it. It's very easy, because you revise your configuration, you plug it up again, it gets changed. Your instances probably don't even restart. You don't even have an outage, right? But you can continuously improve. Containers already give you, through the isolation, a higher level of security, if you use them right. Because there's a lot of debate. And the problem is, when you do certain things that are convenient, like, for instance, use volumes, then you create certain vulnerabilities where you end up almost to the point where, you know, somebody can root your system through a container. So again, if you're purely ephemeral, you don't use volumes, you're far better off. That is part of the locking down as well. Sometimes you may need to think not to do IP-based restrictions, right? So for instance, we restrict SSH access to our stuff that is in the cloud to our IPs. So even if I'm at home and want to work, I have to VPN back to our head office in order to get to the cloud. It's a little bit inconvenient, but it creates more security, right? No default passwords. Always encrypt your communication, especially for privacy concerns, right? Certain entities may still be able to do something about it, but you know, it's not so easy. Public APIs use token systems for authentication. Very, very important. Don't use passwords or something like that. What we use is JSON Web Tokens, JWT. They have a nice side effect that we use for our statelessness. We can put a lot of information in there. So we can, for instance, put in who's the user or which application called or other information that is useful for the processing of the request, right? That again is user independent. The user can't put anything in there. It's what we put in there, right? So it's something that can't be tampered with. A request can be tampered with. Think about SQL injections and all those kind of things. Periodic renewal of token, right? If a token gets captured, it can be used. So renew it, then it can't be used anymore. We put expiry dates in the container, in the token. So that gives us an independent mechanism without even having a revocation process to say that token is not valid anymore. And if you make this period small enough, you probably can't create a lot of damage if you capture them. Another thing, multi-factor authentication, especially for users. Don't let them only use a password, because they are bad with passwords. Right? So use something like, we use Google Authenticator, it's similar like RSA technology. I have that here on my phone, I hope. Yeah, so I have different accounts and they all have their numbers, right? And they change all the time, right? So that's something that's very, very difficult to get around. And there are ways of using that programmatically as well. So app-to-app calls can use a similar technology. So, conclusion. Microservices fit very well the scalable, fast-paced nature needed for IoT backends. You should do continuous deployment. And there's three main parts of management: infrastructure, orchestration, and configuration. And obviously, you want to do good security. So, and we most of the time recruit. So we always look for passionate people who want to work for us. If you have interest, talk to me. Our director of HR is actually today there as well, and we'll be at reception, so there's another person to talk to. Here are two of my guys that you can talk to. We are always interested in having this kind of communication as well with the university. So I think I open up for some questions. I think a little bit more time.
Well, sure, we're supposed to finish at 4, but it's the last talk, so.
Okay. Any questions? Yeah.
So for your last slide on authentication, I noticed that you left out biometrics. A lot of devices more recently, such as the new mobile smartphones, have a biometric function, which the user could put their thumbprint, and there are other sources such as retina scanning and whatnot. How, like, what are the implications, and how secure would it be for something in larger scale for, I guess, commercial and enterprise use?
Well, I'm not 100% sure about that. You have certain additional problems with it. Usually biometrics are more expensive to implement. You need scanners and such things for that. And you can tamper that too, right? So it's at the end, it's some information, some data. If you can put that into the line, then you can fake it, right? So it probably, on the user side, can give you some benefit. But then again, between apps, you can't do it, right? So you need to have a different system anyway, as well, right? So yeah, for user, I'm neutral to that. I'm not sure. We use it, for instance, for our access and so on. So if we use it as a security company, then it probably has some benefits, right? Yeah, any more questions? Yeah.
I guess it's a little bit of a tangent, but with IoT, with the Internet of Things, you have equipment that's it's always going to be abandoned. And so you've talked a bit about how microservices can be used to offer secure services for those IoT devices.
Mm-hmm.
But from a social standpoint, economic standpoint, there's always going to be
Yeah, well, but that again is a point where you start with a very good system, right? So if your system is hardened from the beginning, if it doesn't have any kind of default ways of getting into it, if you have mechanisms like tokens, right? And then you have to get to the point, how do you do that? Like, is there resets or something like that, where you have to have some more intelligence. I mean, currently what is out there, quite frankly, is not very good in a lot of the technologies. Security is often for the vendors the last thing on their mind. And you see that as well with a lot of the automation thing. I don't know, if it's maybe just a little bit more intelligent now because it's not really IoT necessarily, but sometimes it is. So you have those kind of devices that can open your door locks, can open your garage doors, can dim your lights and all these kind of things. They are often based on a technology that I take 30 seconds to break in, right? So basically you have now created, well, I don't know how long it takes from a normal lock. It's probably not so different either if you don't have really reinforced beams and all these kind of things that maybe you should have. You can probably kick in the door too, right? But literally, you can take 30 seconds and take those kind of home automation systems, put them in a reset state, and take them over. And unfortunately, it's because companies don't put enough effort in security. So if you do that from the beginning, even if it gets abandoned, it's probably still more secure than what we have today, right?
I buy that, but at the same time, there's exploits that, say, 15 years ago, they weren't so hot. So cross-site scripting is an example.
Yeah. Yeah.
That was the state of the security at the time. And even if you did have good default passwords, they never anticipated these forms of attacks.
Right.
But by virtue of the device being abandoned,
yeah.
And still being used,
right.
It's in this awkward situation with these dangerous devices that are out in the wild.
Yeah.
I wonder about all our light bulbs.
And I don't think there's one solution for that, right? I think, again, as more as you do automated deployment and continuous deployment, if you do that on devices too in some kind of form, which is its own challenge, it's far easier to do that on a back end than doing on thousands or millions or billions of devices, right? But if there are mechanisms like that, you can mitigate some of those kind of things. Will you ever be 100%? Probably not, right? I mean, the only way to be secure is cut yourself off of the internet. That's how it is, right? And you know, in a certain extent, that is coming out of security on let's say security companies that are honest out as well. We don't say that we can secure somebody 100%, right? There are always things that can happen, but the thing is, usually what we say is maybe something small happens, but as bigger as get, as more harder it is to get away from our detection, right? And I don't know, maybe for that it's not the same example, but maybe there are some things as well that at the end can be put into place that help those kind of things, right? So we are for detection, right? Not for prevention necessarily, because we say you can never 100% prevent, right? You can put a perimeter fence out, but you start pushing holes into it anyway because you want to operate. Because the fence that is 100% secure is, as I said, cutting off the internet, right? And I'm sorry, I can't give you a better solution than that. Yeah? Anybody else? Yeah.
So living now, that after like things that Snowden had said about the NSA putting backdoors into security things,
yeah.
How could you use something here to maybe even look at that, like a backdoor put into something that maybe you hardened your own network already?
Well, the problem with backdoors is, are you the only one who can use them?
No.
Right? I mean, it's the same argument as often I would make with privacy of data, right? You can debate if the NSA should have the right to see certain information or not. That is one discussion. My bigger point is, we know the NSA and the CIA and however these triple letter agencies are called, are not capable of keeping their stuff safe, right? And other people can go and now back on that, and now maybe criminal entities get this information too, right? Or they use the same backdoors, right? I think that is a whole other discussion to have, right? So I don't know. Maybe yes, maybe not. You're not satisfied by that, or? I think backdoors are dangerous. I think backdoors are dangerous. Because backdoors can be used by others. You know, again, when you put in a backdoor, you create a vulnerability that is designed that you can go in there. And if you can do in there, how do you secure it that nobody else can do there? It's safer if you don't have that. Right? That is from a security point of view, I think, in my opinion, pretty clear. Right? I think you wanted to say something? A what?
Single packet authorization.
Oh, with a token?
So it's a software created by Michael Ratch, and it opens a port provided you have the right parameters for a certain amount of time from the specific certain IP address.
Yeah.
That will only allow you to say, for example, SSH in.
But that's like port knocking, right?
Well, it's like port knocking, but port knocking you can scoop. With this, you can't really do replay attack.
Well, yes and no, right? I mean, for instance, a similar mechanism is garage doors, right? Garage door openers, wireless ones, right? They're basically, or car keys, and particularly even more. There are mechanisms how you can basically fake things, so you basically can save a certain number of keys, and then you use those, right? For every mechanism you put in, there's something you can do too, right, against it. Garage door openers, most people don't know, most of the sold garage door openers is these wireless devices. It takes you 30 seconds and you can, I think it was 30 seconds, let's say less than 5 minutes, and you can run actually every single key because there's a mathematical formula how you can condense them because, you know, you have overlaps, right, then, so of keys, and you can basically compress them in a very, very small space, and you can open every garage door in your neighborhood. Right? So you know, the convenience of opening a garage door from your car with this device creates a security problem in some ways, right? The question is what the balance is. Right? And that is again with these backdoors, right? What is the balance, right? It may be useful in some cases. I think I rather go the way of hardening in most cases, except if I have really, really good security around it. Yeah?
During your security section, you mentioned that you have to be careful using volumes with containers.
Yeah.
Can you elaborate more on what the attack vector is there?
You can probably Google it and get exactly the instructions. There's a way, because you can put things in a container, and then you have permissions of changing files. Right, in the host system, because a volume is basically linking the host system with the file system inside the container. Right? And so the idea is, obviously, you can restrict things, right? I was a little bit not really detailed in what I exactly said there. But let's say you have a Docker system where you let everybody run their own Docker container without vetting the images, right? Then I can very easily put in an image that with the combination of volumes now allows me root access to the system, right? So that is the sequence. By writing into the host file system, yeah.
Aren't Docker containers supposed to prevent that?
They don't. And actually, I looked, there was an issue on GitHub about that, and the answer from Docker was, it works as designed. Well, that means know what you do, right? If you create a system that runs Docker containers, then you need to maintain it in a way that certain vulnerabilities won't happen, right? And if you allow volumes, then maybe you have to find a mechanism only allowed to run vetted containers, right? And obviously with containers, there are other things as well you can do. You can use CLAIRE as one of the open source solutions that allows you to scan containers for vulnerabilities, for instance. That's something that I would always advise people to do with containers. So if you combine those kind of things, maybe you can do something about it, right? Or you just say, hey, I don't need that for my use case. I just don't allow any volumes, right? So it's different. Again, it's a question, what is your parameter? What you are allowing through, right? What do you need to do a certain service? Maybe sometimes you need it. But I would challenge, especially for this, for ephemeral containers, you probably don't need to have access to the host system most of the times. If you want to provide state, we are in this SSH for students again. No, I don't know if that is the right solution. I mean, you have to really look into your particular use case, right? It goes a little bit back to what technology is the right fit, right? So maybe you want to do something that the ephemeral way that currently Kubernetes works on is not really the right thing. Maybe pet sets are a solution for you in the future. They are currently in alpha stage. I talked with some Google engineers. He doesn't estimate that they are in production stage for another year or so, because it's a very complex thing. And exactly because of this reason, right? They want to make things very secure in these kind of areas, and as well very reliable, right? You don't want to have, when you replace, for instance, database nodes, you don't want to lose half of your database because of that, right? Anybody else? Yeah. Yes, absolutely, yeah. Yeah, so usually through the containers, you have an isolation, right? Right, your host system is the base layer, and then you put additional layers on top of it, and every layer that is not the highest layer is only read-only, right? The mounting of a volume from the host system is breaching through that and allow you to write into the host system, right? Pardon me?
Your create, read.
Oh, CRUD, yeah.
Yeah, your CRUD operations, you're assuming they're autonomous. So a read doesn't get interrupted and.
Atomic?
Yeah,
atomic.
Well, it depends on which level you see it, right? Obviously, if these things run independent of each other, you cannot prevent that one is not overriding the other. So you have to put additional mechanisms at certain places to, for instance, make sure write operations don't one writes overrides the other one or something like that. Right? Yeah. Yeah, those kind of, there are some additional things you have to do in certain instances. But again, you can get around it depending on what you do, right? So for instance, CRUD has already, or the RESTful implementation of CRUD, or the way you should implement those kind of things, has already certain properties on it. So for instance, a create is not idempotent, right? So every single time you do something, something new happens, right? When you do a put, and you put in the same thing, it would be idempotent. So you can run that multiple times, and that is not a problem. If you run it with different updates, then it's obviously a different story, right? Yeah, but that is why it's important to use the right, you know, methods like get or put or post. So in the past, a lot of times people would use get for an update, and that is a semantic problem now, because now you have something that shouldn't destroy anything being able to destroy something. And when you do authentications and all these kind of things around things, you can say, hey, only certain tokens are allowed to do this particular method like a put, and others are allowed to do, you know, only a get. And this way you can as well put some security around it. Anybody else? Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you very much.